Okay, if we can start the meeting, and can I welcome everyone to the fifth meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in this session. We've received apologies from Rona Mackay, and I can ask people to switch their phones or electronic devices to silent if they have not already done so. Agenda item one is a consideration of continued petitions. Today we'll be considering three continued petitions, each of which has been considered by us for the first time, having been carried over from session four. And the first of these is petition 1548 on national guidance on restraint and seclusion in schools. This petition was lodged by Beth Morrison in February last year. Members will see we have recent submissions from the Children and Young People's Commissioner and the petition. The petitioner's response is positive in terms of the contact with the Scottish Government, but both responses refer to recent recommendations of the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child. These recommendations relate to the issues that the petition raises, and I wonder if members have any suggestions for action. I think one of the things I was struck by was the extent to which the petitioner has been able to make progress, yes, and it seems to have had a positive meeting with the Scottish Government. It might be worthwhile asking for the Scottish Government's comments on, you know, the follow-up of the meeting they had on 22nd September.
Exactly, just an update, really.
Yeah, and I think, I don't know if you were struck by the kind of the strength of the comments from the Children and Young People's Commissioner, particularly on the issue around the further recommendations by the United Nations. And I wonder whether it'd be worth getting an update or getting the Scottish Government's views on those recommendations as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Agreed.
Anything else we could... I think there is clearly quite a lot here,
yeah,
that has emerged, and I think it's just maybe a question of just taking that one wee step further to find out specifically what those, the response to those recommendations might be.
Okay.
Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. If we can then move on to petition 1551 on mandatory reporting of child abuse. This petition was lodged by Scott Pattinson. His most recent submission outlining some of his concerns with progress in this issue is included within our meeting's papers. We have some options set out in the paper, but I would ask members for any thoughts or suggestions they might have for action on this petition.
Convener, I think there's a strong argument to ask the UK government for an update on when it expects to report on the outcome of its consultation, and also to ask the Scottish Government to provide further information on how it intends to engage with the UK Government on the issue of mandatory reporting now that the consultation is closed.
Mm-hmm. So. I think
those
seem reasonable.
Those points.
I was struck by the fact that there isn't complete agreement amongst organisations representing young people that this is the right way to go, that there are issues around mandatory reporting that they would have concerns about. At the same time, you can understand from the point of the petitioner or survivors this, you know, idea that organisations, institutions don't pay attention to what's happening. So I think there is quite a, there is clearly an issue there that we would hope that we'd be looked at further with the Scottish Government or even within the Parliament at some point.
What I wasn't quite clear about is in terms of, I mean, there are issues, people raising issues around, you know, mandatory sort of shouting about this, and I think it seemed to me that the ones that would prefer it are the ones that are, you know, are historical rather than the ones that are immediate. It seemed to me, would I be reading that wrong?
You mean survivors?
Yeah, yeah. So historically, people would have, you know, are looking back, would like it reported, but you know, when you're involved in it at the moment.
Well, I suppose what struck me from the petition was the two separate things. There are where people have concerns and not quite sure where to go. So you work as a school teacher, or you work with children's organising, you're a bit concerned, you don't know where to go, you don't do anything about it. It puts an obligation on you to actually pass those concerns on. There's a separate issue about the extent to which, within organisations, people who wish to abuse children, you know, actively choose to go and work there, because that is a place in which historically we've seen abusers have been able to to operate. And the question is whether the issue of mandatory reporting is about addressing that. I've got a bit of a problem with this, but I don't quite know where to go and concentrate people's minds on their obligations, or addressing this question that institutions are places that can be an opportunity for abuse. And I think there are really difficult issues on either side. And I was very much struck by the fact that children's organisations were not necessarily of a view that mandatory reporting might actually create a problem for the young person. But it's something that we would be interested in Scottish Government's views on that. I think it's slightly more, I think, than just... Cause I'm not quite sure why the Scottish Government wants to await the UK Government's position on it. Presumably they could do something right now, but it would be interesting to hear more general views on that.
I think, Chair, that one is the fact that these organisations are UK-wide, and I think they're drawing on all that information and historic knowledge, and hence I think they've got to get the UK Government's finding before they can come to a decision, because there might be something in there, some Colonel's information that would be helpful, and I certainly would support that.
Okay. So are we agreed then that we will contact UK Government and the Scottish Government for their an update on where they are?
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. We then move on to petition 1596 on InCare Survivor Service Scotland. The principal petitioner for this petition is Paul Anderson, and included with the paper we have a letter from the Scottish Government on the development of the InCare Survivor Support Fund. This was something that was discussed in some detail by our predecessor committee, and I did look at some of the evidence at that point. It was clearly something that the committee at that time also took seriously. But I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions on what action we might wish to take on this petition in light of the Scottish Government's correspondence.
Convener, I think before we decide what action to take, I think it's worth noting that the petitioners stated to this committee in January that they'd like to see the existing ICSSS service continued, but within the proposed model. So I'm particularly pleased to note the Scottish Government's position when it states that while survivors have the option of registering with the Survivor Support Fund, there will be nothing to prevent them from continuing to receive services from their local support services if they meet the fund's access criteria. And this included Open Secret, who I've had some contact with through my constituency. However, that said, I think we do need clarification on the fund's access criteria, which seems to have caused some confusion and difficulty in recent months. There's further information that we need on this.
Okay, I'm going to defer here to you. You two better knowledge in this, I have to say. You've obviously worked in this a lot more than...
I should probably say that from the cross-party group on adult survivors of child sexual abuse and some involvement with survivors of in-care abuse, this is something I feel quite strongly about and are troubled by. And I'm not sure... What Angus says about people can still access these services is important, but I know there are concerns simply about the model that's been suggested. That there is a suggestion, that, if I get this right, that's almost like medicalising the problem. So you deal with the symptoms and the consequences of abuse, as opposed to how do you support a person who's been in that situation in whatever way. Dealing with the trauma of it, and I think certainly some of the people involved in this field are concerned that the trauma aspects of it are not particularly dealt with, and that they prefer to deal with the person who then gets the support wrapped around them rather than going through a series of processes of kind of support, which is not quite in the same way. And so, you know, there is a fund there, and I think the concern might be that fund is moving against the approach that was taken in the past around survivors. I think there's a broader question here as well around what's happening with the inquiry, where I think people on all sides want an inquiry that's going to support survivors and help survivors, but there's been a bit of turmoil around it, to say the very least. We can see it at a UK level, but also at a Scottish level. And I just wonder whether there are some I think we should be seeking an update from the Scottish Government. But I wonder whether there's a bigger issue here that we can explore or ask the Education Committee to explore. It's under John Swinney's remit around this whole question of how we support survivors. It can be about this fund. And I know there have been direct representations to the Minister before the Parliament dissolved, but also around the inquiry so that people can have confidence in what's been done.
I think what's interesting here is we're discussing the perception of the survivors on the current system, whether it's, you know, it's doing what it's supposed to do, and that might be the case, but the perception is that changes might not deliver what they're looking for. So I think we need clarification from two areas: one, for this petition, but secondly, if it is the case, to reassure the survivors that they're going to get the support that they need. So it's all about the perception. So
the question is whether we hold on to the petition and ask for further information, and we maybe seek sort of comments from folk who are working with survivors and people who are delivering services about actually what is the difference, or do we say this is clearly something in a broader context that the Education Committee could be looking at. And I know that as a member of the Education Committee we've taken an interest thus far, and I've had correspondence with the Minister, but we haven't gone so far as going further than that at this stage. So I wonder whether that's really the choice. Do we hold on to it and ask for that information, or do we see this maybe something the Education Committee could look at further in the context of the broader question about the inquiry?
I think we seek the update on the government's position on the Survivor Support Fund and the rollout of it, and then consider again before we send it to the Education Skills Committee.
Yeah,
I think we still need to keep control.
And perhaps, obviously, the opportunity for those with an interest in the petition who may want to provide the committee with further information on how it's working out and whether the concerns have been addressed and whether this question of the actual approach is the wrong approach. I mean, it's a fund that you apply to as opposed to a service that you can draw from, which I think are two different things.
No, I agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's agreed. We will be contacting the Scottish Government and we will ask them for an update, but not afford an opportunity for those with an interest perhaps to respond further. Okay, thank you very much for that, colleagues. Next, agenda item 2 is a consideration of new petitions. And returning now to new petitions, we have 6 to consider. Petition 1613 on taking account of sound sensitivity in regulating antisocial behaviour and environmental health. This petition is by Craig Thompson and calls the Scottish Government to provide for the needs of people who experience sound sensitivity due to disability or medical conditions to be taken into account in legislation and guidance on noise and antisocial behaviour. The petition sets out some background to the petitioner's own experiences. The petition attracted 244 signatures of support and 26 comments. All but one comment supported the petition. Members will also have seen the Spice briefing, which sets out further background information. And I wonder if people have any views or comments on this issue, or how we take this petition forward.
Oh, right. I think this is a really difficult one, to be honest. If I'm not wrong, it's quite predominant in autism to have sound sensitivity.
I think there's some recommendations that the petitioner himself makes around housing and so on, but of course, and that might be something we might want to pursue, but clearly this would apply whether somebody owns their home or is in a social rent sector. Actually, if you're in a social rent sector, there's some flexibility for landlords, but it's more difficult if you're in a position where there is no purchase on your neighbours in that regard. And it's clearly, it's clearly an issue. The whole issue of noise nuisance is something that certainly I've had dealings with in the past.
Yeah, yeah.
And occasionally it can be, you know, poor insulation, it can be somebody being thoughtless or disregarding the needs of their neighbours. In this circumstance, it may be that's a lack of awareness that the level of sensitivity, but also in some circumstances where young people themselves are creating noise because of their own condition can cause disturbance to other people. How do you then deal with that. I think that can be... I think there are big issues, there are very interesting issues here, but I just wonder how best we might progress them.
Chair, I think where I think the most important thing is to talk, to engage the local authorities and the housing associations. Now, that can be done through local authorities as a sort of first kickoff, because they're closest to this issue, and I know from experience this has come up in my area, and it's an ongoing issue in certain different aspects too. But when you talk about sound insulation and insulation, and also pointing where people might go and live, i.e. if it's in social housing, for example, and then there are clear areas that might be better than, and that comes down to local authorities. I think we need to really engage the local authorities on this to get some more feedback as to what their policies are and what they're doing.
So we could go to, I think you're right, local authorities, Scottish Federation of Housing Association. I was very interested in the idea that where somebody has these sound, sensitive to noise, that actually part of your rights to adaptations could be to have your house properly insulated. A little question about the poor insulation and sound insulation in a lot of our properties anyway, but I think that would be useful. Maybe Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, local authorities. Anyone else?
On to that, because it would tie into social services reports on particular cases, which no doubt these may well be within that domain. So I think that is an important.
I'm also thinking, listening to, getting a report back from the sort of Autistic Society or Autism Society as well on their thoughts on this, because they'll obviously have much better figures than we have.
Angus?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think the recent housing standards regulation has helped. Certainly in my experience, I've had a constituent who had sound sensitivities, and part of it was due to, it was social housing, and part of it was due to the council not, ironically, not meeting the new housing standard regulations. But once they were met, then it dealt with the problem. So so there are solutions out there that are definitely worth pursuing. But I think we should maybe also contact Scottish Autism and the National Autistic Society to get their view on the petitioner's petition as well.
And perhaps the Scottish Government to see if they'd... I mean, there is a dilemma, isn't there? It's like... And I think this would be interesting to know from the organisations who represent people with autism, the extent to which it is a problem, the extent to which... You know, the current legislation, part of it might be the current legislation has not been enforced, because there's some suggestion in the petition that even when he could show the noise was very much above the level it should be, nothing happens. There's a question there. But also, if it is reasonable to most people, how do you deal with those circumstances? A question of mediation, I think, comes into that as well. So I think if we can contact or write to the Scottish Government, to the autism organisations, the Federation of Housing Associations, local authorities, and perhaps those who, people with expertise in environmental health, who might be able to give us some advice on how they would see that kind of question, that dilemma being addressed.
For clarification, convener, when we say local authorities, are we writing to COSLA or individual local authorities? Okay. It's fine.
Okay, if that's agreed, we can then move on to petition 1616 on parking legislation. This is a new petition by John Shaw. Members will see that it collected 75 signatures and attracted 8 comments, which were supportive of the petition. The action called for by the petition is to make it an offence to park in front of a dropped kerb. Members have a spice briefing, which provides some context to the issues raised by the petition. This notes that a member's bill by Sandra White, MSP, was introduced in the last session and aimed to implement the action called for by the petition. There were concerns about whether the Scottish Parliament had legislative competence, and the bill fell when the Session 4 Parliament dissolved on 23rd of March 2016. Relevant powers over on-street parking were, however, devolved to Scottish Parliament in the Scotland Act 2016, and the Scottish Government's programme for government in 2016-17 makes a commitment to consult on responsible parking legislation. And I wonder if members have comments or suggestions for action.
I'm going to admit here, I thought it was an offence to park in a drop kerb.
I think it's are we right in thinking it's an offence in other parts of the United Kingdom? Are the petitioners suggest that's the case?
I genuinely thought it was an offence, so it shows you where I sit.
Yeah, we need to get clarity on that, I think. but certainly where the local authorities have come in with now introduced decriminalisation of parking offences, whether that's had any impact in the sudden increase in this. I have a feeling that might be connected.
Okay.
And so I think we probably need to ask the Scottish Government and its views on this, where they stand, because when local authorities were then allowed to decriminalise, I think that's probably may have to be looked at again, in the sense of that particular aspect, which yeah. Brian was referring to.
I think that we would all probably instinct that we you know, understand entirely the position of the petitioner as someone who hates parking and is rubbish at it and gets stressed at the thought of it. There is no doubt there's a lot of selfish parkers out there. You only need to go outside primary schools and at school start time to see the challenges. And if you were trying to get about your business in a wheelchair, there are huge numbers of barriers in your ways. I think it really is a big issue for people. And I know that bill that Sandra White had tried to address some of that. There is also the fact that our streets are really not built for the number of cars to be parked in them in residential areas. So there's a whole big issue here, but I think in relation to that, the point highlighted by John Shaw, I think this is something we would want to get more information on. We could perhaps write to the Scottish Government, ask how they see their commitment in their work in their legislative programme being taken forward in relation to this matter, the review of the question. And I don't know whether there are organisations who might have a particular interest, right, from the point of view of the people who are totally disadvantaged by this, that we could contact as well.
Chair, sorry, I come back to the local authority issue. I think maybe Cosna might, where the roadside, because at the end of the day, it's a delegated authority. Don't get me wrong, the trunk roads, of course, are Transport Scotland. Mm-hmm. But in the main, we're dealing with municipal roads. So I think probably bring in Cosna into that on the roads transport side.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And get their views, yep. Because they would be able to.
I think it's one of the, it's the exact same as disabled parking space. Everybody knows at one level how much of an outrage it is that people selfishly park in them, that can't be enforced, and people get abused and all the rest of it. But it sometimes becomes just too difficult to deal with. And there must be some way where somebody should be able to wheelchair to be able to go about their business without, yeah. You know, and manage that while people are parking at the same
just
time.
Just to clarify, you're suggesting it's not illegal to park in a disability space?
In some cases. I think there actually was legislation went through the Parliament in this regard. Some of it's to do with are they courtesy spaces technically defined as, or whether they have a transportation order. I'm now being completely ignorant about the actual term that's used, but it's an order that has to be put in place by the local authority. But that has been addressed. But I suppose the point I was making more is the attitudes behind it. Mm. Which actually meant it had to be legislated on, which that people would still park in a disabled parking space even if it was clearly marked, which is astonishes me.
I'm learning something new all the time. It's fantastic.
Can I say, Convener, it is unfortunate that Sandra White's bill fell with the dissolution of Session 4. Otherwise, this petition hopefully wouldn't have been necessary. I mean, you see, it was lodged on the 5th of October. So, you know, it is unfortunate that there's been that delay with the bill falling, but hopefully this can help to get a result. Yeah.
It may be that bill may be pursued further by a member, and that's something that even this discussion might highlight to people. I think there's also a suggestion that we take views from Living Street Scotland, Guide Dog Scotland, and Society of Chief Officers of Transportation Scotland, all of whom may have a view on this. And I think, you know, if there are other organisations who, perhaps disability organisations themselves, who want to highlight their concerns, this would be an opportunity for them to feed in as well. If that's agreed. Okay, thank you very much, colleagues. Can we move on then to petition 1617 on a proposed health study, vaccinated versus non-vaccinated? This petition is by Angus Files. This petition calls for a study of the effects or health outcomes for those who have been fully vaccinated according to guidelines compared to those who have not. The petition indicates that this is not something the Scottish Government has previously considered undertaking. The briefing refers to petitions from Session 4, which also related to vaccination practice and policy. One of these petitions was also from Mr. Files. And I wonder if members have any views or on action to take on this petition.
I thought this would be done as a matter of course. I think if you're doing mass vaccinations, you would want to have keep quite a tight, stringent look at that. So I'm surprised it's not done as a matter of course. And it can't be that difficult.
Well, I think it's probably something slightly different. I mean, I presume people who clinically understand the consequence and the choice that made around vaccinations will keep that under close scrutiny. I think the suggestion here is that you would compare those who are vaccinated against those who are not vaccinated. I'm not sure how you could do that. If the group that was not been vaccinated were not then getting the benefits of vaccination, I'm not sure how that would work.
I suppose the issue here is around confidentiality, patient confidentiality, I suppose. You would know who's been vaccinated, and by proxy then who's not been vaccinated, I would have thought. And then subsequently, any issues?
I suppose the question then is, if public policy is that we believe it's the interest of the child to be vaccinated, rather than having that discussion about why that vaccination is worthwhile, you say, OK, you've made that choice, now let's compare whether you were right or not, which doesn't feel to me to be... I'm not sure whether ethically the medical profession would support that. There is a point made here in the SPICE briefing which says this global consensus, which is on vaccination, holds that it would be unethical to carry out any such trial because it would mean depriving people involved in the trial of vaccinations against infectious diseases.
I wasn't suggesting that we do that kind of trial as in withhold, but there will be those who have been vaccinated and there will be those who have decided not to be vaccinated, and then from that you'll be able to extrapolate out and see in terms of health how they've developed over that period of time. So, but then that comes down to patient confidentiality, whether that information can be accessed. Mm-hmm. I would certainly be against.
I think the ethical dilemma is if there is a view that this vaccination is in the interest of all of us, that there is everyone is vaccinated, rather than arguing with someone who's chosen or somebody who hasn't, as opposed to choosing not to, but somebody who's not been vaccinated, rather than saying to them, which I would have thought would have been the position by health professionals, saying, well, this is actually in your interest, you should do this, rather than use them instead as a control group against to judge whether they were right or wrong.
I think that's absolutely the ethics are involved in that, but and certainly around patient confidentiality, but we wouldn't have to set any trial up because those conditions never exist. And I'm quite interested to see where we do stand ethically in that.
Mm-hmm. Chair, I'm sure if you think about it, when a young child is vaccinated in the first year, I mean, there are records held on that anyway, available with National Health. Now, that's obviously if the parent chooses to have the child vaccinated, and most people do. And then if you look at the mortality rates of the population, that must be, the information must be there to indicate on that side of it.
Presumably, it informs the medical profession's view of the benefits of vaccination or whether indeed you any longer need vaccination because there's no longer a threat of disease.
Yeah.
But I think there are some people who may actively choose. There must be some people in our community who simply miss out for all sorts of different reasons. I'm not sure, therefore, they should be a group against which you confirm the benefits of vaccination.
I mean, if you look at the flu vaccination, I mean, that's inverted commas a control group because the over 65s, for example, have the choice, but more and more people seem to be doing that. So I think some of the evidence is already there in the domain, but it's, as you say, it's a long-term thing, this, and the manufacturers and their trials, of course, do that in a smaller scale.
Well, I think it's an ethics question.
Mm-hmm. Would it be worth then seeking the views of the Scottish Government the petition? They may be able to highlight exactly what that challenge is.
I think so.
I would have thought that, you know, at the point where there is a decision around the benefits of vaccination, a lot of this has been tested, and they take the view not only is it an individual interest, but there's a collective interest in vaccination in order to protect all of us. And I suppose even just to get them to confirm that would be useful.
Okay.
And I think it's also what their policy is on getting that information out into the public domain to recommend.
Okay. Is that agreed then?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, thanks very much. If we can now move on to petition 1611 on mental health services in Scotland. This is a new petition by Angela Hamilton. Members will see that the petition collected 270 signatures online and 144 signatures offline. The petition also attracted 26 comments which were supportive of its aims. Members have a copy of the petition, which is calling for action on three issues regarding waiting time targets and funding to primary care and third sector services. Angela had been going to be at the meeting today, but is unfortunately unwell. She has, however, provided a written submission that expands a little on the information that is in the petition and provides some examples of experiences that people have had of accessing mental health services. It also sets out information about local mental health associations that she's aware of and has been invited to observe in her own area. And we shall, of course, make sure that her submission is put into the public domain, as it is actually very informative. And I think we had actively chosen to take evidence, and this is clearly an issue that's of concern to Angela Hamilton, but probably resonates quite strongly with issues that we've picked up more generally around the whole question of mental health services. And so, you know, it would have been really good if Angela had been able to be here today, and I'm sure we wish her a speedy recovery and thank her for submitting the petition in the first place. And I wonder if people have any suggestions about how we take this forward.
I think it's fair to say, you know, that Parliament's taking the issue of mental health a lot more rigorously and seriously in this term than perhaps has in the past. So I think we would agree. I'm quite sure that we would want to reduce, you know, waiting times. As much as we possibly could. In terms of just arbitrarily reducing that term to a figure, I'm not sure how practical that is, but...
Well, yeah, the target's not been met at all, that in itself. I mean, I think there are benefits of targets, even if they expose the problems in delivering the target, but, I mean, certainly she flags up there is consistent under-achievement on targets. And I think there is a question about the role both of public National Health Service, but also she speaks quite powerfully about the importance of third sector organisations.
Yeah.
It goes back again to an early petition, the way in which third sector organisations can support people maybe in a different way.
Well, I think, you know, it's quite interesting. I've done a little bit of work in this particular area myself, and I think that the third sector and voluntary sector certainly seem to lead the way. It can probably teach us quite a lot in this in this environment. But as I said, if we're not making the 18-week as much as we would like, I think arbitrarily reducing that, I don't know what that has impact on in this current term. I think we need to understand. I think a clarification on Scottish Government's action plan to start hitting current targets.
One of the things I think for information to note is that the Health and Sports Committee will lead a short inquiry on mental health services in November 2016, looking at waiting time targets and the implementation of the previous mental health strategy. So it may be that the option we do have is to close the petition on the understanding we're referring it to the Health Committee. We'll be referring it to them.
Yeah.
Because they're doing this inquiry, I think the information that Angela Hamilton has provided and the way in which she's described that is very useful. And we would hope that the Health Committee would be able to, you know, take that information and feed it into the inquiry. It's clearly, I think it's already been said across the Parliament, there's a concern about this question, but it is then about delivering on a policy. We can all agree on a policy, but if you don't then look at what stops it being delivered, yeah, or what the challenges are, I think there is an issue with that. Don't know whether people have a view on that approach.
And I like that approach, you know.
I'd agree with that, Chair. I think it's part of the bigger inquiry.
Okay.
Yeah, I would agree, Convener, especially given that the two short inquiries are imminent. I think they're due to start next month, so the sooner it's referred, the better.
Okay. And I think, again, we want to thank Angela Hamilton for a petition. I think we do recognise the significance of what has been highlighted, and we know that in the Health and Sport Committee, they too understand that, so we'd refer it to them as part of your inquiry. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. If we can then move on to petition 1618 on combating motorcycle theft. And a slight change to the running order on our agenda, the next petition we will consider is by Carl Grundy on behalf of Riders Club Edinburgh. Carl is unable to attend the meeting today. Members will see that the petition collected 1,196 signatures and attracted 110 comments, which were supportive of its aims. Members have a copy of the petition, which is calling for action on combating motorcycle theft and related offences. I think we could seek views on the petition from the Scottish Government and Police Scotland, and it may be that perhaps whether all of us or one or two of us could meet with the petitioner in order to understand the issues raised in the petition. I think that would be useful. But I would suggest we could do this informally, given our meeting schedule. I wonder if members have a view on those suggestions.
Definitely think it's worth meeting.
Yes, I would support that.
Okay. Agreed. So we can set that up, and with those members who are able to attend, that would be useful. And again, to speak to Scottish Government and Police Scotland about the issues that are highlighted.
Yep.
Is that agreed? Okay. Thank you very much. Can we just take a short break before the next item? Suspend the meeting. resume the meeting and welcome you back. And can I welcome Mark Ruskell to the meeting, who is here for this item. We're now turning to petition 1615 on a state-regulated system for game bird hunting in Scotland. Our final petition for today was lodged by Logan Steele on behalf of Scottish Raptor Study Group, and as the clerk's note indicates, received over 7,000 signatures and just over 600 comments in support of what it seeks to achieve. Members will be aware that we have recently received written submissions from RSPB Scotland, Scottish Land and Estates, and the Scottish Countryside Alliance. Can I welcome Logan Steele to the committee, along with Duncan Orr Ewing, Head of Species and Land Management, RSPB Scotland, and Andrea Hudspeth, who is Treasurer and Raptor Surveyor for the Tayside Raptor Study Group. Welcome and thank you for attending today. I think you have the opportunity now to make a brief opening statement, after which we will move to questions from the committee.
Okay, good morning. We're first of all delighted to have received 7,600 signatures from across the UK, and I think it demonstrates the public feeling on this issue. Scottish Raptor Study Group members are volunteers with day jobs from lawyers, conservation workers to council workers. Duncan, Andrea and I are fairly typical of the 270 members we have across Scotland. We are passionate about raptors and their conservation. Annually, we monitor around 6,000 sites outside the survey year, and we're guided by government licences and a scientific approach and accreditation by SNH. And subject to a code of practice and annual returns, all the data we collect is supplied back to Scottish Natural Heritage. We are patient, reasonable people, guided by sound science, informed by debate. Persecution black spots across Scotland are in Angus, Invernessshire, Donside, and parts of Southern Uplands. And Scotland has an international reputation for expert raptor workers. We are not against game bird shooting, just the illegal elements of it, and we have no wish to ban it. We understand the importance of game bird shooting as part of the rural economy. We work with crofters, farmers, stalkers, shepherds, landowners, and gamekeepers. However, our patience with the criminal end of the game shooting industry is at an end. Over years, we've seen prevarication, obfuscation, and leadership failing by the landowning and game representatives' interests. The government's own review conducted by SNH last year admitted there's a serious problem with moorland management and grouse shooting. Just a quick explanation, there's two forms of grouse shooting, walk-up and driven. Walk-up is where guests will walk up a hillside with guns and shoot at grouse flushed from their feet. That's low intensity and doesn't feature too much in the criminal activity on driven grouse moors. Driven grouse moors is a business that depends upon huge numbers of birds at the end of the breeding season to be shot by guests. The problem the driven grouse shooting industry have is that they cannot rely on these big bags of grouse to shoot unless they undertake illegal raptor persecution, because raptors themselves would eat that surplus. So the driven grouse shooting industry need to continue with the killing, otherwise our business model is flawed. The Scottish Government should be welcomed for taking many steps in the last few years to try and reduce this, key amongst which was vicarious liability and the tightening up of general licences and two poison amnesties. Birds of prey have been protected since 1954. We would say the killing is cultural and an entrenched part of sporting estates and goes back to Victorian times. It's seen as an extractive business rather than a sustainable one, and we need to move to a model more in harmony with the environment. Since the early 90s, there's been a series of initiatives, including Partnership Working, PAW Scotland, Raptor Working Group, Langham Moor Demonstration Project, Police Review, Thematic Review of Wildlife Crime, Moorland Forum, but the killing continues. It's difficult to bring a prosecution due to the geography, the burden of proof, the wall of silence when a crime is found. Crimes occur in remote places, easy to conceal, difficult to detect. Corroboration under Scots law requires two witnesses, and we also have, as we well know, limited police resources. There's an overwhelming body of science from the RSPB and the government's own statutory conservation body, SNH, and there's also compelling evidence and intelligence on where these crimes are occurring, added to which is our members' experience on the ground, where in many cases, in ideal habitat, certain key species are absent. Tactics that our members are finding, but not necessarily illegal, are gas bangers, gas guns, inflatable scarecrows, ice, guns discharged over birds, burning of nests and heather banks, and torching of golden eagle eyries. These things are not illegal, but they certainly don't help or encourage birds of prey to breed. In parts of Scotland, the situation is getting worse because of the intensification of management, such as the killing of deer, mountain hares, draining, burning on deep peatlands, creating hill tracks without planning permission, and the burning out of scrub and juniper. The golden eagle is Scotland's tiger, and it's been grubbed out in grouse moors, which damages Scotland's image of the world and affects green tourism and the wild rural environment. So our patience has run out. We need a step change. In a civilised country, we do not tolerate a business sector that conducts its affairs outside the law. We maintain that no other land use or industry is allowed to behave in this way. We have established that in other countries where game bird hunting is better regulated, we've found that intensive game bird hunting systems are not permitted, and there's far better compliance with wildlife and environmental protection laws. This is why we're calling for the licensing of game bird shooting to be introduced. My final comment is that, perversely, a licensing approach may actually save the grouse shooting industry from themselves, which has patently failed to do over the decades. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for that. If I can just start by saying that, you know, you say that self-regulation by the game bird shooting sector in Scotland has patently failed. Do you think it's failed because there's no commitment to it, or because, I mean, you seemed to suggest earlier on that it wouldn't work, it doesn't work in terms from their point of view of what they actually need to do in terms of making the business sustainable? And how do you square your very clear view that there are things that are not illegal but are causing damage? How do you square that with the view that's presented from the other side, that actually this problem is not as severe as you suggest?
Well, part of the reason why the actions taken have failed is primarily down to the very difficult task of actually proving a criminal case. So we know, for example, that killings are taking place in wild, remote moors, difficult to find. We need two independent witnesses to corroborate a crime. And these crimes are taking place in very quiet, remote areas. There's no lack of appetite from the government, the police, SNH, and the other public bodies to try and crack down on this. It's just largely down to the inability to prove the offences. We will hear, or we have heard from certain landowning interests, that this is only a small problem. There's a huge body of science produced by RSPB and SNH that there's huge swathes of Scotland with certain key raptors absent, which is largely down to, or entirely down to, the land use that is put to.
View is that the business is aware of this, but they really don't want to confront it.
Well, like I said previously, they don't want to confront it. Like I said, driven grouse shooting depends on large numbers of surplus birds at the end of the breeding season. And without this large surplus to be shot by guests, the business will not be viable. And this is why they're so reluctant to stop the killing, because if they do stop the killing and abide by the law, they will not have the surplus to shoot, and the businesses will be devoid of revenue and income to run the business.
So does that mean that you agree with the view that, I mean, I'm perhaps describing unfairly the view of those who are involved in the business, that they have, in order to sustain these jobs and to sustain this work, they have to do, I mean, they would deny, presumably, that there's any criminal activity, but you're saying it's inevitable, but does that therefore mean that you can't have that kind of grouse shooting then?
I'll pass to my colleague Duncan, or Ewing, who'd like to add.
I was just going to add, I mean, I think the Scottish Land and Estates and Scottish Country Alliance responses to this petition are indicative, really, of the problem. I mean, they are very much aware of the scale of the problem. I mean, I'm involved with the Partnership Against Wildlife Crime. All of this information has been presented to them over quite a number of years, but still they deny the scale of the impact, which we see regularly on the ground. This is a systematic and endemic problem. They are clearly out of touch with what is happening on the ground and what we see. And what I've asked in advance of this meeting, I asked the clerk to the committee to actually circulate the RSPB Scotland 20-year illegal killing of bird of prey in Scotland report, which summarises the number of incidents that have been recorded over the years and also the scale of the impact on populations of birds of prey in Scotland. This is an overwhelming case which the government accepts, SNH accepts, successive environment ministers have accepted the scale of the problem, but clearly we are not proposing that game bird hunting is banned. simply better regulated to try and get rid of the illegal element within the midst of this sector. Hunting jobs would continue, but what we are saying is that we do need a less intensified game bird hunting model to deliver a wider range of public goods. And this is reinforced by the recent Scottish Natural Heritage Scientific Advisory Committee Moorland Management Review. We think that by moving to this less intensified model, you will actually diversify the opportunities for rural development, which are at the moment are largely dominated by hunting interests.
Okay, Angus McDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. If we were to accept that self-regulation has failed, and there's clearly indications, as you've highlighted in your preamble, that is the case in various parts of Scotland, why do you consider that a licensing system would be the solution?
I'll pass Duncan to comment on this too.
Okay, so just briefly, I'll try and summarise this. As I say, we're not proposing a banning of game bird hunting, simply better regulation to improve standards and protect the public interest. Game bird hunting in the UK is known to be amongst the most intensive and least regulated in Europe and North America. We have an SNH review that is underway of hunting licensing systems across Europe, which will be published shortly. In Scotland, we have other state-regulated systems for natural resources management, such as water, for example. SEPA regulate water abstraction, impoundment, and so forth. We also have systems of regulation for both deer and wild fisheries. So we would argue, why should game bird hunting be any different? What we're proposing is that a licensing system would work alongside existing package of sanctions that are available, such as vicarious liability, penalties for convictions, that kind of thing. A license would be issued by Scottish Government to allow hunting to take place. This could be to an individual or to a geographic hunting area. This would be self-financed. So SNH, if they administered this system, would charge for a hunting license, which would cover the administration, similar to the SEPA system for consents for water. We would suggest that it is supported by a code of sustainable game bird hunting practice, which sets out the standards which should be adhered to. Similarly, in the deer world, we have a code of sustainable deer management practice, which could provide a model. And we're assuming that the license will be a civil and administrative process supported by additional criminal sanctions for non-compliance. So, for example, hunting without a license. We suggest that this is delivered on a civil burden of proof, similar to the removal of the open general license, which SNH administer already, and that, therefore, the burden of evidence is on balance of probabilities, because currently the criminal burden of proof is very difficult given where these crimes occur and the difficulty in gaining sufficient evidence to stand up in court.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned vicarious liability there in your answer. Now, you'll be aware, last week, committees of the UK Parliament took evidence on petitions relating to grouse shooting. And in the course of this evidence, comments were made on the vicarious liability measures in the 2011 Act. Jeff Knott of the RSPB observed that, although not a silver bullet, these measures have started to have a greater deterrent effect. Is there not an argument that the 2011 legislation needs more time to bed in and its impacts to be evaluated before licensing or indeed any other measure should be considered for introduction?
Yes.
I mean, I know there was a comment earlier that your patience has run out, but at the same time, should we not wait and see if the 2011 legislation works?
Okay, so firstly, vicarious liability was introduced under the Wildlife and Natural Environment Act in 2011, and it makes landowners responsible for the actions of their employees in relation to the illegal killing of birds of prey. It relies on a criminal burden of proof. Since it came in, only two landowners have been successfully convicted under this legislation, both of whom actually are relatively small players in the game bird sport or hunting world. The area of most concern, actually, in terms of crimes against birds of prey is land managed for driven grouse shooting. These very intensive, high input, high output in terms of game bag, high intensity management systems, which are not being touched at the present time, it would seem, by vicarious liability. I'm afraid, you know, if vicarious liability is to work, it has got to touch these kind of very intensive game bird hunting systems. Otherwise, it's not going to act as a deterrent.
Can I also add that over my 40 years' experience with raptor working and dealing with persecution, there's always an initiative on the way. Let's wait for this to happen. Let's wait for this to change. Let's give it 3 or 4 more years. Let's see what this working party could do. Let's rejig the rules and regulations. And if I got a pound for every time we had an initiative that came along to solve the problem, I'd be a rich man.
Okay. That response is helpful.
Thank you. Brian Whittle.
I think one of the things we would note to start with is because of, by definition, the few numbers of raptors that are going to be out there, any loss is always going to be significant. But I think that what I'd like to ask is, you know, your petition observes that good wildlife laws are now in place in Scotland to protect birds of prey, and goes on to say that enforcement of wildlife protection laws has historically been inadequately resourced, as compounded by the remote locations involved. And I would ask, that would increasing resources for enforcement potentially be a solution rather than a licensing system?
We have over time had additional training for procurator fiscals, and we've had specific wildlife crime officers appointed, and they were, and still are, quite active in their own areas. But I think if you even doubled or trebled the boots on the ground, because the crime takes place in wild, remote areas, as I said before, with the requirement of 2 witnesses to corroborate the crime, I don't think it would overcome things.
Okay.
I could just add to that. In 2008, there was a thematic review of the penalties and enforcement of wildlife crime by Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary, which made a number of recommendations for improving the enforcement, a number of which have been implemented. But still, the whole area of combating wildlife crime and enforcement of wildlife crime by the police is under-resourced. I mean, if you are going to do this effectively, you need something like the US Fish and Wildlife Service, which you may be familiar with, who have very extensive powers to stop and search and to tackle wildlife crime out on the ground.
Okay, thank you.
Morris Corey?
Yes. Can I ask, I was struck by your suggestion that the laws are routinely flouted. Are the trends in the information about wildlife crime that demonstrate this to be the case?
Yes, it does. Apart from the counting of dead bodies, what we're finding is that as each subsequent population survey has been completed, the Golden Eagle was last year, we did the Hen Harrier this year, and the Peregrine survey, which involves the whole of Scotland being surveyed for peregrine falcons, hen harrier and golden eagle. And each subsequent survey, and I understand the golden eagle survey is yet to be published, is indicating a continual absence of raptors from key areas. On top of that, we're also getting more and more feedback from satellite tagging of hen harrier and golden eagles. And you may be aware that there's been a number of incidents just this year of harriers and golden eagles disappearing, which were sat tagged over areas used primarily for driven grouse.
Right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, any further questions? Mark, do you want to come in at this point?
I just wanted to make a point, convener, because I think that, you know, there's widespread public concern out there about the impacts, particularly of driven grouse moor shooting, and the petition that Angus MacDonald referred to that's been considered at Westminster, I think, attracted 125,000 signatures. Many of those petitioners, those signatures, were coming from rural constituencies in Scotland. And we also know that there's a separate petition that I think this committee will hear in the weeks to come concerning the persecution of mountain hares by driven grouse moor estates. So I think there's a lot of environmental concerns to unpack around this issue. I have a question in my own mind about whether a licensing regime would actually be effective and how it could be implemented. But I think the best course of action would be for this to be, in my mind, would be for this to be referred to the Environment, Climate Change, Land Reform Committee, where I know that there's been a lot of interest and discussion amongst members around a broader inquiry which looks at the future of our uplands and some of the tensions that exist between different forms of land use. And I personally feel that a petition like this and possibly subsequent petitions that are coming to this committee to be referred to the Eclair Committee would provide us a really strong anchor to consider the wider environmental impacts of upland land management, of which this is only a part of.
Can I just say one of the things I'm struck by is the extent to which you appear to have no faith in the commitments that have been made in terms of, you say that, you know, people keep saying there's going to be action and so on. I just want to clarify with you, you've referred to a current Scottish National Heritage Review of game bird licensing systems in Europe, but say that the review will apparently make no recommendations for further action. I wonder, you maybe could say a little more about why you take that view. But you also, your petition calls for the implementation of the recommendations of the Review of Wildlife Crime Penalties in Scotland. Now, that review, the review this refers to was one that reports in November 2015. Our notes show that the Scottish Government responded to this in February. In that response, the Government accepted the recommendations, including the introduction of tough new penalties. I wonder what your understanding of that is, because, again, I mean, to go back to the point that Mark Ruskell makes, you suggest a licensing scheme, but that seems to be driven by frustration that whatever is being suggested never actually gets, never really makes a difference you want to see.
Andrew, do you want to handle
something? Yeah, I mean, I think my colleagues have sort of touched on this point already, is the burden of proof. So we can increase the penalties for wildlife crime, but that still puts the burden on us, on people on the ground actually looking for wildlife crime. And also, these wildlife crimes being corroborated, as we've said, by two independent witnesses. So I've only really come into this arena in the last 6 years. So for me, what I've seen on the ground is unbelievable. I have been astonished by what I've seen and what I've seen people get away with. And the problem is, if you're out there on your own, you're monitoring raptors, there is no one to corroborate what you've seen. So I can report, and my reports can improve intelligence for the police, it can go on record, but it doesn't actually lead to convictions. It's very hard to bring a case before the courts for a conviction to be successful. And it's a very long-winded and very expensive process as well. So we don't really think... We accept that this is a step forward, and you know, we welcome the recommendations of that report, and we do think it will help. But we think that needs to be part of this whole suite of a regulated system for driven grouse shooting. So, as you suggest, not said, vicarious liability is not a silver bullet. None of these things on their own are going to be a silver bullet. We need to have a whole suite of regulations and standards by which the whole industry has to adhere to, if we are to see any real benefits.
With regards to the S&H report, I mean, and more widely, you know, Scottish Government efforts to tackle wildlife crime, you know, since the inception of the Scottish Parliament, it has been very welcome the attention that the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government have given to wildlife crime, and some of the measures that have been introduced are now amongst the best in Europe. But in most of the rest of Europe, they have regulated systems of game bird hunting, which sit alongside the penalties and the criminal sanctions. It is very disappointing that the S&H report is not going to make recommendations, and we would hope that this committee would encourage some recommendations to come out of that S&H licensing review to inform next steps here.
Can I ask, just go back to the point, what makes you believe that there will be no recommendations from that report? Is that what you've been told?
I understand it is a review without recommendations, but you may know differently.
That might be a worthwhile question to ask. It's not something that I do know, but it would be interesting. You seem very clear about that, and I'm not sure of an instance where you have a review that doesn't then draw you to conclusions, which would then perhaps suggest certain actions, but that's something we can obviously... Stabs, are there any other questions?
Just, I've got a comment on the frustrating thing. If it's a continuation of sort of flotation of these laws and a continuing loss of raptors, I think it's almost an inevitable drive towards legislation that I fear would be difficult to prosecute. And you know, I find it extraordinarily frustrating because I think we would know that this kind of legislation is so difficult to, because of the remoteness of the area, it's so difficult to prosecute. And if these laws continue to be flouted, it will drive inevitably towards something probably that's very difficult to prosecute.
The concern would be that those who are of criminal intent rely on the fact that it's unenforceable. It's not that and I suppose that's why the legislation, the framework matters, because it would appear there's some evidence that there are those who simply are not going to be persuaded. Clearly there will be a lot of people who have been persuaded, but there are others who are not persuaded of the importance of this. I don't know if you've got any last comments you want to make before we draw some conclusions.
Can I make one comment, please? The Raptor Group members find it hugely embarrassing that in a country like Scotland, we've got a sector of the business sustained by criminality. And there's no other walk of society, no other business in Scotland who carries on their activity blatantly breaking the law. And furthermore, their business is underpinned by illegality, which I just find absolutely abhorrent. And that rides over and above any concerns regarding birds of prey. But as a sheer principle of living in a civilised society, I find it absolutely amazing.
Okay. Will you want to say something further?
I was just going to add, the core of this problem really is the high intensity of game bird hunting systems that are allowed in Scotland. Driven grouse shooting, these high-intensity pheasant releases, there are over 50 million pheasants that are released in the UK every year. In most other countries, these kind of systems of hunting, which aren't really in touch with the natural environment, are not sustainable, are not allowed. And that is because they have regulated hunting systems which govern what is and isn't allowed and sets the standards and codes for behaviour. And that is the missing part of the equation here. We have that in relation to deer management. We have the Deer Scotland Act 1996. We have CEPA governing other natural parts of natural resource management in terms of water. We have the Aquaculture and Wild Fisheries Act, which governs how fisheries are managed in Scotland. Yet game bird hunting has no form of regulation.
One thing that I'd really like to sort of draw your attention to, really, and that is some of the arguments that the industry will come up against, it will put forward, is how vital their businesses are to rural economies in Scotland. And I would just counter that to say nature-based tourism actually contributes 1.4 billion to the Scottish economy and supports 39,000 jobs. Now, if we keep depleting our natural resources, or if we allow for our natural resources, our protected species, to keep being persecuted in this way, that can only surely damage our nature tourism industry, because if we no longer have species of interest for people to come to our country to see, we're going to lose out in that way. And that's a personal issue for me, as that's part of my business. And I can see myself and other people in my industry finding it harder and harder to actually find the wildlife to show to visitors. And I think in a country that really has a invaluable reputation for its nature, we can't allow there to be people out there persecuting it and depleting it.
Okay.
Can I just, one further point. Just to bring that issue into sharp focus, I was on the Hebrides in June this year with my wife on a bird watching walking holiday. And on the Macher, we met some American tourists who I quickly got in a conversation about, and they were very well versed with the raptor persecution in Scotland. And they were appalled that it goes on for reasons we've already discussed. And I said to them, would you coming back to Scotland? And they said, well, one thing for sure, we're not going to Cairngorms National Park. I said, why not? They said, because of the criminal goings on with raptor persecution over there. So they will not be visiting the Cairngorms National Park because of the issues with raptor persecution. So I said, are you not coming back to Scotland? Oh no, we're coming back next year. We're going to Orkney and Shetland. There's no bird of prey persecution up there. So that's a little wee anecdote, which none of us would ordinarily see, and I'm sure it's happening in lots of little wee places all over Scotland where people are consciously making a decision to spend their pound in, as Andrea says, the green ecotourism environment and not where criminal persecution is going on with raptors, such as one of our famed national parks.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. I wonder if members have any comments on how we take this forward.
Can I comment? I mean, I think it's very interesting what the team were saying there about the current deer management programs and wild fishery management program. I know a little bit about the deer management one, and certainly it's been very successful. I see no reason why the Scottish Government should review this issue in relation to that. In other words, the success of wild fisheries and deer management, mm-hmm. and apply the same principles.
Okay. Anyone else?
Well, I have to say, in my experience, deer management has not been successful to date. There's a lot left, a lot to be desired in that respect. I'm keen to, I'm in a quandary actually, because I'm keen to seek more information from the Scottish Government's views on the petition, particularly with regard to the findings of the review of game bird licensing and legislation in other European countries, because I'm keen to find out exactly what's happening elsewhere. But at the same time, I take on board Mark Ruskell's suggestion that we should refer the petition to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, because it's about to undertake scrutiny of the Wildlife Crime Annual Report. But not knowing exactly when the annual report's coming out, it means we could maybe have some time in this committee to get information from the Scottish Government. So I'm in two minds.
I mean, I'm struck by the force of what you say, and it's a huge charges you're laying at the doors of those who are alleged to be involved in criminal activity, and it doesn't feel to me that kind of charge is something that, through the Public Petitions Committee, it feels like something that could be explored in more detail by the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, and I would like to see it being referred on that basis, because it would then afford people the opportunity to say, in return, you know, what has been alleged is so serious, this is our response to it, and it would give people be able to do that in depth, and I think people would probably agree on that. But I do think it would be worthwhile just seeking the Scottish Government's view specifically on this question of where they've got to with the publication of findings, the review of game bird licence, so on, as you have said, and just get an update from them on that, which at least we can then feed in as well, because part of what comes across is not just a passion about your belief about what is going on and how bad that is, but the way in which, through the process, there are delays built in and commitments which don't then really match up with the scale of the challenge that you represent. So I wonder if the committee agrees that we should refer the petition to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, and urging them to reflect the evidence we've had so far, just about how frustrated and concerned you are, which I think will then prompt a response from the other side of the argument, which they can then take forward. But that we do ask the Scottish Government just for an update on where they are.
I'm kind of torn on this one. I'm kind of reticent to let it go, to be honest. I think that having heard evidence from this side of the argument, I would really like to hear, I'd like to see the other side of the argument sitting there as well, mm-hmm. so we could. That's me personally. I'm just saying, because I think the reality is, I think we all know in here that the there's no doubt that raptors are being persecuted in some way, in some circumstances. I mean, I think that the news tells us that, you know, and recently that's happened, and you know, I think that ultimately it's going to come down to the Environment and Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. I think, but. I kind of feel incomplete, if you like, the fact that we haven't got the other side here to question and query. I don't know what everybody else thinks about that.
I suppose the commitment we might be looking for from, and we can only ask, we can't insist of other committees what they do and what they don't do, but in referring the petition to them, underline the scale of the significance of the challenges that have been made, or the charges that have been made, and the importance of those being responded to. Because, I mean, to suggest that it's actually affecting our tourism trade, or that people perceive that there is a very significant industry in Scotland underpinned by criminality, that's a very, very serious thing to have said. So I think it's not so much where that question has been asked, but in the fact that it should be asked. My own view is that probably the expertise inside the Environment Committee would allow that to be put in context.
just going to say, I mean, just in terms of the scale of this, I mentioned earlier that the RSPB 20-year review has just been circulated. I mean, just to give you one point, confirmed bird of prey persecution offences were detected on over 200 identified land holdings between 1994 and 2014, covering 10% of Scotland's land area, which kind of gives you a flavour of the extent of the problem. And this involved 779 confirmed victims.
And this is just the tip of the iceberg. This is the ones we find. God knows how many there are that go undetected. Mm-hmm.
Is that 200 separate landholdings?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
It's endemic.
In terms of what this committee can do, if we were told on to it, we would be looking at your proposition that a licensing scheme should be explored. That is what we would be doing. The broader question of actually scale is a problem. If in referring the petition, it would then be put in that context by the Environment Committee, and I wonder whether that would... I don't think there's any stopping us asking for an information and update. I understand Brian's reluctance to let it go, because it would be interesting to hear what the case for the defence is. But I wonder whether, in our consideration, because we would have to be looking at the licensing as an option, we would still not be in a place where we could look at these broader questions of what the other options might be.
Plus, Convener, I am concerned that if we do extend the period that this committee is looking at it, we could find ourselves in a situation where the Wildlife Crime Annual Report is issued and the petition is still sitting here rather than sitting with the ECCLR committee. So I think we should refer it
Can we
today.
Get agreement on that?
The way he was looking at me. they are better placed than us, there's no doubt about it.
This is always something open to members, is that they can attend other committees and, you know, can make representation at an individual level around actually the impact this evidence has been on you. Yeah. You want to share that with the committee, the same way that Mark Ruskell has been able to come here today. So perhaps with that we can have agreement that I think we should look to the Scottish Government to get an update, but we've already had the views of the various organisations, as we've said, but also to refer the petition to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee for consideration as part of its anticipated scrutiny of the Wildlife Crime Annual Report. And it may be the clerks could liaise with the clerk to just so that we're not referring it on to something that's not going to happen and get a reassurance from that this is something they're actually definitely going to be doing.
I'd also like to be aware of when it was going to be heard.
Points we made, if we refer it without that being checked out, we would then lose it. So perhaps what we can do is defer the decision on referring it to our next meeting, and by then we will have all the information about when the timescale and timetable for the committee doing that. And I think, you know, we're not in a position where we can direct another committee, but equally we wouldn't want to lose it and then discover they're not going to be able to do anything with it. So if that was agreed, we can defer the decision specifically on deferring the petition to our next meeting. Is that acceptable?
Yes, I accept
that. Yep.
Okay. I think that's fair enough, Convener.
And the clerks will, of course, liaise with the committee in that regard. And certainly, I think that, there, again, for individual members to make contact with the committee to say that when they are considering this, you would wish to be informed. I'm sure that's something that's possible. Okay, so if that's agreed, can I thank our witnesses for coming along today. Thank you very much for your time. Can I also thank Mark Ruskell for being here. The clerk and team will be back in touch with you about where we are with everything that's going on. And I just thank everyone for their attendance today and close the meeting.